I happened upon one of Dwayne's videos on YouTube, and it's a biblical Hebrew awakening video. And it caught my interest because I was already convicted that we are the people. The information in the video was very informative. It was consistent. Some of the readings that was being done, it was consistent with what's in scripture. I could follow, and I haven't stopped watching since. And here I am, awaiting and expecting continued enlightenment and illumination with regards to the word of Yah. So welcome everybody, and hope we have a good session.
Hello, yeah. All right, let's see here. Next, go ahead, last four of your phone number, 9565.
Okay, my name is Michael Watson, and I'm originally from the Caribbean, even though I live in North America. I live in San Antonio, Texas. And I came awake back in 2016, and I had no clue. I was raised in the church. I'm from, by the way, I'm from Belize. I had no clue. I was raised in the church, Sunday school, church, mm-hmm. You know, my grandmother, she was the matriarch of the family. And she made sure that we attended church and Sunday school and VBS and all right. That kind of stuff. So, that's all I have right now.
No worries. Thank you very much. All right. Go ahead. And Kirk, go ahead and jump right in.
Shalom, everyone. My name is Kirk from Antigua. I lived in Atlanta for a while. Some of the people first introduced me to the scriptures and like how to read it and understand it. There in Miami is where I'm just like kind of relocating from between here and Miami right now. So definitely just in search of, you know, truth and being able to stay on course for the purpose of whatever I'm here to do to serve, you know.
Pleasure. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. We have Debbie. Go ahead and jump right in.
Hi, everyone. I'm Debbie. Sheryl and I are friends, and that is how I heard about you, Dwayne. So she watched the video and she forwarded it to me, and I watched it and it was interesting. I liked how you spoke, and I liked the fact that it seemed to be our Father centered as opposed to world centered or church centered or, you know, that kind of center. And so she listens more than I do, but I'm following mm-hmm. along. And so far I have liked the way you present things, and I find it interesting, and I'm looking forward to drawing closer to us as a people. I'm looking forward to the unification of us as a people under our Father, so that we can go home and this farce of a world that we are living in can come to an end.
Absolutely. Amen. Hallelujah on that one. I appreciate your words. Shadallah, go ahead.
Hello, everyone. I'm Shadallah. I am from the U.S., Tennessee in the U.S. I fellowship with those in the U.S. On the Shabbat, but want to connect with as many of my brothers and sisters around the world as possible, because I believe we just, we all have something to contribute to one another. So I'm gonna leave it right there, and I'll probably be on mute, but shalom.
All right, thank you. Also, don't be shy to provide your input or insight as we go forward, because again, this is gonna be more, as our very first one, this is gonna be more of a discussion and question and answer than some type of a formal teaching, although I do have some things prepared that I need for us to get into. So just don't be afraid on that one. All right, and then Linda, go ahead.
Shalom, Mishpacha. I am here in North Carolina. Also, you know, have been following more Ray Dwayne for maybe about 3 months, but I'm not new to the awakening. And I just wanted to have an ear to be present in the discussion with our Caribbean brothers and sisters. I have had the opportunity to visit the Caribbean, the pleasure to stay there for about 5 months. Love the culture, and that is my interest.
Pleasure. All right. And then last but not least, Lydia, go ahead and introduce yourself.
Shalom, everyone. I am Lydia. I know Ak Dwayne because he started our assembly in San Antonio. I am originally born in Africa, Togo, and therefore my first language is French. And I moved to the United States in San Antonio back in 2007, so it's been a while. We've been in the awakening since 2014, but really following Torah and observing the Shabbat since about 2017.
Praise God. And Lydia's gonna be helping me kind of translate or interpret some of the key things that I might be saying. So I greatly appreciate you, Lydia, for being here to help assist our brothers and sisters, because I'm telling you right now, I know some of them are probably shy. When I put the call out, and I actually did a Facebook ad specific to the Caribbean in regards to this, and I had so many people contact me, French. I'm like, wait, what is it, what? Okay. I've dialogued with many people just via like a translator. And then it was either French or it was Spanish. So I greatly appreciate you being here. What I would ask for you to do is try to translate some of the key things that I say to those that are French speaking only.
Okay.
I'm going to be in the book of Jubilees, chapter 1. And one second here. That's going to be vital for us to even go forward. So I'm going to let you guys know, the very first thing I do, any assembly that I establish, I go visit, whatever. If I'm just visiting or establishing an assembly, I always go to Jubilees chapter 1 because it's something that we need to address and understand. So right now I'm trying to translate what someone just sent me because I have no idea what they just wrote. But then I'm going to move forward because, if they want to jump on, they'll jump on. All right. So, let me just address some things here. And Lydia, if you can, I will leave some spacing for you to translate in French for me. Are you able to do that for me, please?
Yes, of course.
Okay. So, let me just say, just repeat what I say. Okay, I'm just going to kind of, we're going to work through this together, okay? All right, so my name is Dwayne Harris.
Je m'appelle Dwayne Harris.
And today I wanted to initiate a fellowship with those of you in the Caribbean.
Et aujourd'hui, je voulais faire un appel avec vous dans les îles des Caraïbes.
We are one people.
Nous sommes un peuple.
That have been scattered throughout the earth.
Qui a été envoyé tout au long de la terre.
But it's time for us to come back together again.
Et il est temps finalement de revenir ensemble.
There are many voices that are speaking to you about where we come from.
Il y a beaucoup de différentes voix qui parlent de ce qui se passe en ce moment.
But we need to focus on the truth and not conjecture.
Mais il faut rester concentré sur la vérité.
Many will come to you and say we are Egyptian.
Beaucoup de personnes vous diront que nous sommes égyptiens.
Some will say we are Moors.
Certains diront que nous sommes des Moors.
But the truth of the matter,
mais la vérité,
is that we are the descendants of the biblical Hebrew Israelites.
Nous sommes les descendants de la Bible, des Hébreux de la Bible.
It may be hard for many of you to receive that or understand that.
C'est difficile parfois d'accepter ça ou de recevoir cette idée.
But it's the truth.
Mais c'est la vérité.
We have to embrace the truth and not the lie.
Nous devons accepter la vérité et ne plus écouter les mensonges.
Many of us follow the religion of Christianity.
Beaucoup d'entre nous suivons la religion chrétienne.
We love God.
Nous aimons Dieu.
We love Jesus.
Nous aimons Jésus.
We have had authentic, real experiences with God, with Jesus, and in church.
Nous avons eu des expériences très authentiques avec Dieu, Jésus, à l'église.
That being said, the truth is still the truth. We are the descendants of the biblical Hebrew Israelites.
Mais la vérité est la vérité. Nous sommes les descendants des Hébreux israélites de la Bible.
Right now, I'm going to go into a passage of scripture from a hidden book called the Book of Jubilees.
Maintenant, je vais lire un passage d'un livre qui est caché, qui s'appelle des Jubilés.
This is likely one of the first times this has been done.
C'est probablement la première fois que vous allez entendre ça.
But we are going to do a reading of this and have it translated in French for you to understand.
Mais nous allons lire ce livre et le traduire en français pour que vous compreniez.
Alright, we're going to pause for a second. Thank you. All right. So in general, I don't want her to have to translate everything, but we're going to go forward right now and we're going to read the Book of Jubilees. So if you have the Book of Jubilees, go ahead and get it, read it. I have that available to read in English on the website, HebrewConnect.org. But for right now, I'm going to read this because this speaks to the situation that we were in and that we came up in. Okay. This is a particular passage of scripture that deals with Moses on the mountain when he was receiving the instructions from the Most High God. Okay. And so, Lydia, we're going to go ahead and begin right now. Those of you just joining us right now, thank you for joining us. We are getting into our reading. And we will open up for open dialogue and discussion later. So right now we're going to go into the reading of chapter 1 of the Book of Jubilees. Again, this is Moses on the mountaintop receiving instructions from the Most High Yah, or as some know, the Most High God.
May I ask a question before you begin?
Yes.
Do you have any background information as to the origin of the Book of Jubilees?
Yes. So the Book of Jubilees is an ancient work. It is what is called a pseudepigraphal work, which means in layman's terms, the root of it is that this is a work that is so old and ancient that no one knows who the original authors were. It's like equivalent to finding the writings in the Dead Sea Scrolls, like the caves of the Dead Sea. It's like we don't know specifically who wrote them or collected them. We know like the Essenes as a people, but that's what we're dealing with. We're dealing with the writings of our ancestors that essentially carried down the instructions down through time. And so these are works, and this particular one is a work that is, number one, is bulletproof. It aligns 100% with the Bible that we know. And all the academic scholars, like it's 100%, like it's bulletproof. It's a situation where a lot of those in academia study the book. They have meetings annually every year to study the books of Jubilees and some of the other apocryphal works. They study them in depth. Whereas the layman church pastors and preachers know of this, even teach from it, but they don't disclose where they're getting their information from. Whereas for me, I'm going to tell you where I get my information from. And I present everything to you so you can learn for yourself. Okay. So Lydia, if you want to translate that the best you can in your own words to kind of convey that, go ahead, please. I appreciate that.
Donc, le livre de Jubilé, c'est un livre qui a été retiré de la Bible. Et qu'il représente l'histoire, le début de la Bible, l'histoire d'Abraham et de la création. Donc, c'est un livre qui est très important parce que c'est un livre qui est catégorisé dans les livres perdus et qui ont été enlevés pour nous cacher la vérité.
Okay, we're going to begin, and I'll try to not go on a huge chunk, just so you can kind of keep up with it. So let's begin, Lydia. Here I go. This is the history of the division of the days of the law and the testimony.
C'est l'histoire de la division des lois et des témoignages.
Of the events of the years.
Et des événements des années,
of their weeks,
des semaines,
of their jubilees,
des jubilés,
throughout all the years of the world,
tout au long des années de la terre,
as the Lord spake to Moses on Mount Sinai,
comme le Seigneur a parlé sur le Mont Sinai.
When he went up to receive the tablets of the law and the commandments.
Quand Moses est monté pour recevoir les tablettes des commandements.
This was done according to the voice of God as he said unto him, go up to the top of the mountain.
Va au haut de la montagne, comme le dit la voix de Dieu.
And it came to pass in the first year of the exodus of the children of Israel out of Egypt.
Et la première année de l'exode des enfants d'Israël en dehors de l'Égypte.
In the third month on the 16th day of the month.
Et le troisième mois du sixième jour du mois.
That God spake to Moses saying, come up to me.
Le Seigneur a parlé à Moïse et lui a dit, viens me voir.
Come up to me on the mount, and I will give thee two tablets of stone of the law and of the commandment.
So, viens me voir sur la montagne, et je te donnerai deux tablettes avec les dix commandements.
Which I have written that you may teach them.
Que j'ai écrit pour que tu puisses les enseigner.
And Moses went up into the mount of God, and the glory of the Lord abode on Mount Sinai.
Et Moïse est allé au-dessus de la montagne du Seigneur, et la gloire du Seigneur était au-dessus du Mont Sinai.
And a cloud overshadowed it 6 days.
Et un nuage l'a caché pendant 6 jours.
And he called to Moses on the 7th day out of the midst of the cloud. And the appearance of the glory of the Lord was like a flaming fire on top of the mount.
Et il a appelé Moïse le 7e jour au milieu du nuage et a apparu toute la gloire du Seigneur avec un feu au-dessus de la montagne.
And Moses was on the mount 40 days and 40 nights, and God taught him the earlier in the latter history of the division of all the days of the law and a testimony.
Et Moïse est monté à la montagne pour 40 jours et 40 nuits, et le Seigneur lui a montré le début et la fin de l'histoire de la division de tous les jours de la loi et des témoignages.
And he said, incline thine heart to every word which I shall speak to thee on this mount, and write them in a book, in order that their generations may see how I have not forsaken them for all the evil which they have wrought in transgressing the covenant.
Et il lui a dit, viens écouter avec ton cœur chaque mot que je t'ai parlé sur la montagne. Et écris-les dans le livre pour que toutes les générations ne l'oublient jamais. Et que, l'ennemi ne puisse pas les transgresser et que tu gardes le contrat que j'ai établi entre moi et toi et les générations dans le Mont Sinaï.
This is the covenant which I established between me and thee for their generations this day on Mount Sinai. I think you got that already. All right. And thus it will come to pass when all these things come upon them that they will recognize that I am more righteous than they in all their judgments and in all their actions, and they will recognize that I have truly been with them.
Et du temps est passé. Et toutes les choses sont venues au-dessus d'eux et il les a reconnues. Et il y a plus de vérité tant que les jugements et toutes les actions. Et il les reconnaît et il les a bien reçus.
And do thou write for thyself all these words which I declare unto you this day. For I know their rebellion and their stiff-necked before I bring them into the land of which I swear to their fathers, to Abraham, to Isaac, to Jacob, saying, unto your seed will I give a land flowing with milk and honey.
Et écris pour toi-même tous les mots que je t'ai déclarés ce jour, et je sais parce que ils se rebellent. Et ils ont un cœur dur avant que je les emmène dans la terre promise que j'ai juré à leur père Abraham, Isaac et Jacob. en leur disant pour leur génération qui sont dans la terre, qui que le lait et le miel sont sur cette terre.
All right, now this next part is very important for us to understand because the Most High literally tells Moses from the jump, from the beginning, what we're going to do.
Donc cette partie que nous allons lire est très importante parce que le Seigneur va dire à Moïse ce qu'il doit faire.
And they will eat and be satisfied, and they will turn to strange gods, to gods which cannot deliver them for aught of their tribulation. And this witness shall be heard for a witness against them.
Et ils vont manger et être rassasiés, et ils vont se tourner vers des dieux étranges, des dieux qui ne pourront pas les délivrer de leur situation troublante.
For they will forget all my commandments, even all that I command them, and they will walk after the Gentiles, and after their uncleanness, and after their shame, and will serve their gods, and these will prove unto them an offense, a tribulation, an affliction, and a snare.
Et ils seront les témoins de ce que j'ai entendu contre eux, parce qu'ils vont oublier tous mes commandements que je leur ai commandés, et ils vont marcher avec les ennemis, et ils vont être salis, et ils auront la honte, et ils vont servir leur Dieu, et ils vont prouver avec eux des offenses, des troubles, beaucoup de problèmes.
And many will perish, and they will be taken captive, and will fall into the hands of the enemy, because they have forsaken my ordinances and my commandments and my feast days of my covenant, my Sabbaths, my holy place, which I have hallowed for myself in their midst, in my tabernacle, in my sanctuary, which I have hallowed for myself in the midst of the land, that I should set my name upon it, and that it should dwell there.
Et beaucoup d'entre eux vont mourir. Ils vont être pris captifs et ils vont tomber dans les mains de l'ennemi parce qu'ils ont laissé mes ordonnances. Ils n'ont pas écouté mes commandements. Ils n'ont pas observé mes festivals, mon alliance, mes shabbats, ma place qui est au-dessus de tout. Et ils vont m'oublier et ils vont aussi laisser mon tabernacle et mon sanctuaire que je vais leur donner moi-même au milieu de la terre. Et ils vont oublier mon nom que je vais mettre au-dessus d'eux. Et ils devront rester où ils sont.
And they will make to themselves high places and groves and graven or carved images, and they will worship each his own carved image so as to go astray, and they will sacrifice their children to demons and to all the works of the error of their hearts.
Et ils vont faire eux-mêmes des images dans les places hautes, et ils vont louer ces images et ils vont s'éloigner de moi et ils vont sacrifier leurs enfants aux démons et tous les travaux et les erreurs de leur cœur.
And I will send witnesses unto them, prophets, that I may witness against them, but they will not hear, and will slay the witnesses also, and they will persecute those who seek the law, and they will abrogate and change everything so as to work evil before my eyes.
Et je vais envoyer des témoins, des prophètes, mais ils ne vont pas les écouter. Ils vont témoigner contre eux et ils vont les tuer et ils vont les persécuter pour ceux qui suivent ma loi. Et ils vont changer, ils vont tout changer et ils vont faire des travaux qu'ils sont très démoniaques à mes yeux.
Okay, so here's the part that we have to understand as a people, especially those of us in the Caribbean, those of us throughout the entire diaspora. This part right here.
Donc c'est une partie très importante à comprendre quand on est dans les Caraïbes ou dans la diaspora.
And I will hide my face from them, and I will deliver them into the hand of the Gentiles for captivity and for a prey and for devouring. And I will remove them from the midst of the land, and I will scatter them amongst the Gentiles.
Et je cacherai ma face et je le délivrerai dans les mains des ennemis pour la captivité, comme une proie, pour les dévorer. Et ils vont je vais les enlever au milieu de cette terre. Et je vais les disperser tout en dehors avec les ennemis.
I'm trying to get through this, y'all.
Yes, me too.
And they will forget all my law and all my commandments and all my judgments and will go astray after new moons, Sabbaths, festivals, jubilees, and ordinances.
Et ils vont oublier toutes mes lois et tous mes commandements et tous mes jugements. Et ils vont partir comme une nouvelle lune de Shabbat, des festivals et des jubilés et mes ordonnances.
And after this, they will turn to me from amongst the Gentiles with all their heart, with all their soul, with all their strength. And I will gather them from amongst all the Gentiles, and they will seek me so that I shall be found of them when they seek me with all their heart and with all their soul.
Ils vont se tourner vers moi de leur ennemi et ils vont me donner leur cœur et avec toutes leurs âmes et toutes leurs forces. Ils vont se regrouper au milieu des ennemis et ils vont chercher ma face et ils vont me trouver et ils vont chercher avec tout leur cœur et toutes leurs âmes.
And I will disclose to them abounding peace with righteousness. And I will plant them with uprightness, with all my heart and with all my soul. And they shall be for a blessing and not for a curse. And they shall be the head and not the tail.
Hallelujah. Et je vais leur donner la paix et la vérité qu'ils ont besoin. Et je vais les enlever de cette place qui n'a pas de bonté. Et avec tout mon cœur et toute mon âme, je vais leur donner une bénédiction et je ne vais plus les abattre et je vais ils seront la tête et ils ne seront plus la queue.
And I will build my sanctuary in their midst, and I will dwell with them, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people in truth and in righteousness.
Et je vais bâtir mon sanctuaire au milieu d'eux, et je vais être avec eux, et je serai leur Dieu. Et ce seront mon peuple dans la vérité et dans la bonté.
And I will not forsake them nor fail them, for I am the Lord their God.
Et je ne vais jamais les laisser, et je ne vais jamais les faire ne pas réussir, parce que je suis leur Seigneur, leur Dieu.
Now, Moses replies back and says something in pleading for us as his people. And I'm going to give you, right here in the text, the Most High Yah's response.
So now Moses, Moïse va répondre et il va supplier Dieu. Pour son peuple. Et on va vous donner la réponse de Dieu.
And Moses fell on his face and prayed, saying, O Lord my God, do not forsake thy people, thy inheritance, so that they should wander in the error of the hearts. Do not let them and leave them, do not deliver them into the hands of their enemies, the Gentiles, lest they should rule over them and cause them to sin against you.
Et Moïse est tombé sur sa face, et il a prié et il a supplié, saying, Ô Seigneur, mon Dieu, s'il te plaît, ne nous oublie pas, n'oublie pas ton peuple, n'oublie pas ton héritage, parce que nous sommes là dans l'erreur de notre cœur. S'il te plaît, ne nous remets pas dans les mains de nos ennemis. Et s'il te plaît, reste avec nous et nous pourrons régner sur eux parce que nous ne voulons pas pécher contre toi.
Let thy mercy, O Lord, be lifted up upon thy people and create in them an upright spirit and let not the spirit of Baal rule over them to accuse them before you and to ensnare them from all the paths of righteousness so that they may perish from before thy face.
Que ta miséricorde, ô Seigneur, nous aide à nous relever, ton peuple. S'il te plaît, renouvelle en nous un esprit droit. Ne nous laisse pas avec l'esprit de Béliard. Être au-dessus de nous et nous accuser devant toi. S'il te plaît, ne nous laisse pas dans les voies qui ne sont pas droites. Que nous allons mourir au devant de ta face.
But they are thy people and thy inheritance, which thou hast delivered with great power from the hands of the Egyptians. Create in them a clean heart and a holy spirit, and let them not be ensnared in their sins from henceforth until eternity.
Mais ce sont ton peuple et ton héritage que nous avons délivré avec un grand pouvoir dans les mains des Égyptiens. Crée en nous, s'il te plaît, un cœur propre, un esprit saint, et s'il te plaît, ne nous laisse pas dans les péchés jusqu'à l'éternité.
And the Lord said unto Moses, I know their contrariness and their thoughts and their stiff-neckedness. they will not be obedient till they confess their own sin and the sin of their fathers. And after this, they will turn to me in all uprightness and with all their heart and with all their soul. And I will circumcise the foreskin of their heart and the foreskin of their heart of their seed. And I will create in them a holy spirit, and I will cleanse them so that they shall not turn away from me from that day unto eternity.
Et le Seigneur dit à Moïse, je connais leur contrariété, je connais leurs pensées et leur cœur est fermé. Et ils ne vont pas être, ils ne vont pas m'obéir jusqu'à ce qu'ils confessent leur propre péché et le péché de leur père. Après ça, je me tournerai vers eux et je leur donnerai un cœur propre, un cœur pur et un esprit saint et leurs âmes. Et je vais leur circoncire la peau de leur cœur et la peau de leur cœur et de leur génération, de leurs enfants. Et je vais créer en eux un esprit saint. Et je vais les nettoyer de la tête aux pieds pour qu'ils ne se tournent plus contre moi jusqu'au jour de leur éternité.
And their souls will cleave to me and to all my commandments, and they will fulfill my commandments, and I will be their father, and they shall be my children.
Et leurs âmes vont s'attacher à moi et à tous mes commandements. Et ils vont pouvoir compléter tous mes commandements et les observer. Et je serai leur père et ils seront mes enfants.
And they all shall be called children of the living God. And every angel and every spirit shall know, yea, they shall know that these are my children and that I am their father in uprightness and righteousness and that I love them.
Et ils seront appelés mes enfants, les enfants du Dieu vivant. Et chaque ange et chaque esprit sauront qu'ils sont mes enfants et que je suis leur père. Dans toute la pureté et la bonté et dans l'amour que j'ai pour eux.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. Woo! I need a break. I need a break. This is, I know it's intense for you too, Lydia. I appreciate you so much.
Thank you.
I'm going to read this last part and then we're going to open up for question and answer and dialogue and discussion. It then goes on to say, and do thou write down for thyself all these words which I declare unto thee on this mountain, the first and the last, which shall come to pass in all the division of the days, in the law, in the testimony, and in the weeks, and the jubilees unto eternity, until I descend and dwell with them throughout eternity.
Écris pour toi tous les mots que j'ai déclarés, que je t'ai déclarés sur la montagne. Le premier et le dernier, qu'ils devront passer dans toute la division des jours de la loi et des témoignages, dans les semaines et les jubilés jusqu'à l'éternité. Jusqu'à ce que je redescende et que je vienne rester avec vous jusqu'à l'éternité.
Hallelujah. Okay, so we're done with that. Closing out with that. We're not going to read the rest of that. You can read it on your own.
Nous allons pas continuer. Nous allons finir ici. Et si vous pouvez trouver le livre des jubilés et le lire par vous-même.
Okay, so for those of you guys here on the call right now, before we go into open dialogue and discussion in general and discuss some things from the heart, does anybody have any thoughts? Does anybody have any questions in regards to what we just read? Go ahead and unmute yourself and chime on in.
Duane, this was intense for us as it was intense for you. I mean, I've been familiar with the Book of Jubilees for some time now. But reading this through again, especially verse 8, just brought me to a point where I felt like I just want to cry.
Right.
I just want to cry. Because, I mean, this outlines what we will, from that time, what we will do. And I mean, it just fits us. And I think for a lot of us, when we come out of our Christian experiences, like I have, and you read this, you realize all this time, what we've been doing is after the Gentiles. I mean, it's hard. It's hard reading it through here again. It is really, really difficult. And for me personally, it is impetus to not go back. I cannot go back. We have to move forward. And so for me, moving forward means relearning all the commandments which we were given from way back then, relearning them, applying them so that we can achieve, maybe not onto perfection at this point in time, because it's just so messed up. Mm-hmm. But hopefully come close enough to that so that we can usher in or allow the Most High to recognize that, okay, your effort, I see the effort. These people trying. Mm-hmm. They're ready. And so he can send back our Messiah to gather us and deliver us and take us to where we were meant to be. So this is a hard read.
Yes, it's very necessary. I have more to add to that, but I want to keep going. Anyone else, especially if you're friends with Sheryl, jump right in. What are your thoughts?
You know, Sheryl said she was almost moved to tears. I was in tears. I mean, it's so heartbreaking to know that despite being told everything that would happen, that our forefathers still condescended into this, and that they have allowed us to reach to this point where we are, where when we watch the news and we see how badly we are treated, mm-hmm. and that we are, you know, the scriptures say not the tail, but it feels like if there was something beyond the tail, then that is what we are no. But, you know, just to know that at the end of it, he says, I am going to take you back because you are mine. You are my inheritance. You shall be the head and not the tail. And he's going to dwell and you will be my people in truth and in righteousness. And I will not forsake nor fail you. And that gives you such a lift. Because although we are down in the doldrums now and we are at the depths of despair, the light is there at the end of the tunnel and it's there. You know, you can barely see it, but it's there. And if we just hold on and just keep going and just keep trusting and just remember him and do as he has said we should do, that light is going to burst forth one day. And I am so looking forward to that. So,
absolutely. Praise God. Anyone else? Jump right in.
Wayne, I would like to say, you know, verse 15 was the verse that really struck me, because I've learned a lot, and it just It's just because it goes right along with, you know, how Christianity was introduced to us, and all the things that came out of Christianity, you know, where it says here, it talks about the new moon and the Shabbat and the feast, you know, how all those were changed to like Christmas and Easter and all these things.
Halloween.
You know, Halloween, you know, that we learned. It just struck me because every time I try to tell some of my family members about, you know, this walk and what we're in, and they're still, they still can't, just look like they still can't get it, you know? But that's the verse that really, as you were reading and Lydia was reading, that's what struck me the most.
Thank you. Anybody else jump right in?
Yeah, I would like also like to add that, you know, it was very, very comforting to know that this is in verse 16, where he says he will disclose abounding shalom with righteousness. So, I mean, this is a hope. This is something that we look forward to, because what we're experiencing here now in our present existence, it's way too chaotic. It's just crazy. And I am looking forward to this time when we can all just get along in peace, right, and in righteousness, not having to worry about, you know, you got to lock all your doors. Is somebody going to scam you today? You know, just righteousness and peace. And it's a good hope. We need to get this hope, have this hope within us and keep it alive, especially at this point in time. You know, and it's really good to know that even though Moses was told that this is what we're going to do and we're going to be sent into captivity for our prey and for devouring, yet I am going to take you all back, as Debbie said, and the end is going to be much better than it was before. It's really hopeful.
All right, one second here. One moment. Very good. Anyone else have anything they want to add? Okay. Anyone else have anything they want to add? Okay. I'm going to say this. It's a lot on my heart right now. One of the things that our people that are in Christianity have a problem with is they think that, well, number one, we have a pride issue as a people. So you already know, like, don't nobody want to admit we were wrong all this time. Yeah, we were wrong all this time. But what I tell people is that the experiences you had, the majority of the experiences you had in Christianity, in the church, were authentic, they were real. The Most High has kept you, even in your ignorance, throughout this path you've been on. Some people that wake into this awakening, I have so many things on my mind right now. When they wake up to this awakening, right, they come to this awakening, it's something where they think, people think that you're saying their experience wasn't real. The experience is real, all right? But you have to understand that the Most High has kept you on this path, all right? We're all learning, we're all growing. Some people come into this awakening from Christianity. Some come from Islam. Some come from atheism, or they're just agnostic. They're just like, I believe there is a thing like God, but I really don't know. What you have to understand, though, is that we are the people of the book. That's it. That's it. We're the people.
Can I say something?
Yes.
I think, you know, like you said earlier, it's pride. I think pride and arrogance, it clouds our mind, you know, to receive the truth a lot of the time, you know, because like I said earlier, I try to tell friends and family, and, you know, I get all these questions, and I know we have to be patient with them and pray for them. But you can see it. You can see it clearly. It's kind of frustrating because how come I can see it, but you can't see it? And that's kind of what's frustrating to me, you know. But I know patience is the...
Yeah. Patience. So prayer is the most important thing we can do for our family members and loved ones. I find that in most cases, they're not going to be able to receive from you. Like your brother, your sister, your son, your daughter, your mother, your father may not be able to receive from you. They're going to receive the seed you plant. They won't let you know that, but they are. And then it's going to be up for someone else to water that and to water it with the word from the Most High that will then bring that up. Meaning, I'm not from the Caribbean, yet the Most High has put it on my heart and my ministry, which is Biblical Hebrew Awakening, is to go and reach our people where they're at. Awake them up. That's what it comes down to. We have to wake up as a people. There are some people in the Caribbean that may wake up because their brother from America was able to come reach out to them, even with a language barrier, and tell them the truth. See, there's things that those in the diaspora in the Caribbean know that we don't know, that I don't know. And there's things that I know that those in the Caribbean don't know. And we definitely have to bring that together. Like, listen, you're my people. I'm your brother. That's just what it is. Like, I need you. You need me. All this beef in between islands and beef in between these folks and that folks. And then, like, oh, y'all, I'm trying to hold on. Oh, I'm trying to hold on. I'm trying not to jump off. Because y'all, if anybody knows me, know I can jump off. Oh, we have to keep it together. We have to keep it together. We have to love one another. Period. That's it. We got to stop running around trying to be something we're not. Listen. The devil don't care what you want to be. You can say, I'm a tree. Have at it. You could be a boy trying to say you a girl. You could be a girl trying to claim you a boy. You know, listen, you could be a Muslim. You could be a Moor. You could be a Jehovah's Witness. You could be Methodist, Baptist. Listen, whatever you want to be, aside from the truth of who you really are, you want to scare somebody, you let them know the truth. I know who I am. I am an Israelite. My forefathers and foremothers are the biblical Hebrew Israelites. No one else alive today on this earth fits the description like us. Everybody else knows where they come from. There's two people groups on this earth that use terms to describe themselves that are not authentically true. White people that hide their identity because they don't want you to know where they come from. So they'll go with white. Although there's like European this and that, whatever, but those are all like aliases too, right? So they have no problem embracing the term white because it's ambiguous. Don't nobody know where they came from, right? So we white too, we white, right? And then you got us that they label black. No, we not black, that's a color. And I understand you go Negro, they use Negro, Negra, Nigger, you are a blackie, a darkie, you are African-American, you're colored. Okay, you're a black woman. Now you're a woman of color, because we gotta keep inventing new things for y'all to embrace. Okay, like I said, these folks don't care what you run to, as long as you don't run towards the truth of Torah, the truth of who you are, where you come from. They don't want you to know the truth that your mothers and fathers were the little bitty children that were ripped from the arms of their parents in Spain, France, Portugal. When you see these slave movies, they sit there and they show you the slave movie, and the slave movie is like, they got like, you know, look like a 25-year-old strapping man and full-blown women. And then when you look at the slave databases, you see that the majority of the people that they took were like 13. 9, 8. They took children on those slave ships.
And they were raping them too.
Our people don't understand that in Spain, Portugal, and France, our forefathers lived in Europe. There's a whole deep history we'll get into next time. But eventually what ended up happening, and if you can, Lydia, I'm going to go ahead and just go ahead and interpret what I'm saying right now.
Yes.
All right, so for those of you guys listening.
Pour ceux qui écoutent.
I'm explaining what happened to our forefathers and foremothers.
J'explique ce qui s'est passé pour nos pères et nos mères devant nous.
This is a history that has not been openly taught.
C'est une histoire qui n'a pas été, que nous n'avons jamais entendu parler.
For us that live in the Caribbean,
pour ceux qui vivent dans les Caraïbes,
the Americas,
aux États-Unis, en Amérique,
even parts of West Africa,
et même dans l'ouest de l'Afrique.
Our forefathers, our people were not always originally there.
Nos parents avant nous n'étaient pas de ces régions originellement.
Just like us, most of you cannot trace your history beyond 1600.
Comme nous, la plupart d'entre vous ne peuvent pas retracer leur histoire avant 1600.
The reason being is that history was hidden.
La raison pour laquelle est que notre histoire était cachée.
Our forefathers and foremothers,
nos parents et nos mères et nos pères avant nous,
were originally in Spain, Portugal, and France.
Était originellement en Espagne, Portugal et France.
This is what was during called the Dark Ages.
C'est ce qu'on appelle les années noires.
What then ended up happening?
Et ce qui s'est passé après ça?
Was we were also living amongst our brothers, or you could say our cousins, that were Muslim.
Nous vivions avec nos frères et sœurs qui étaient musulmans.
These are those that you would consider Moors.
Ce sont eux que vous pouvez considérer les Maures.
The original Moors, as you should know, were Negro.
Les morts originaux étaient ce qu'on appelle les Negros.
When the Moors were expelled from Europe,
quand les morts ont été rejetés ou expulsés de l'Europe,
you have a incursion of European tribes from the east.
Il y a eu beaucoup de tribus européennes de l'est.
They came in taking over.
Ils sont venus et ils ont pris le pouvoir.
And instituted or started the inquisitions.
Et ont commencé ce qu'on appelle l'inquisition.
During the inquisitions, our children were ripped from the arms of their mothers, their fathers, and their grandparents, and they were forced to be converted into Christianity.
Pendant l'acquisition, les enfants ont été enlevés des parents et de leurs grands-parents et ils ont été forcés à se convertir à la chrétienté.
Specifically, Catholicism.
Tout particulièrement le catholicisme.
So, during this time, the children were forced baptized into Christianity and then they were enslaved to work on plantations.
Pendant ce temps, ils ont été forcés et baptisés dans la chrétienté et ont travaillé comme des esclaves.
These were the children of the true Sephardic Jews of Europe.
Ce sont les enfants des véritables Jewish ou Hébreux de la région Sephardique.
Your name was stripped from you, your language was stripped from you, and you were forbidden to read or have anything to do with your language or culture.
Ils ont pris votre nom, ils ont pris votre culture, ils ont pris votre langage et vous étiez forcé à ne pas lire et à ne pas utiliser votre langage.
Some of you that may be in Sao Tome, you have direct lineage and ancestry from some of those first families that were expelled from Europe.
Vous qui êtes à Saint-Thomé, vous avez probablement des premiers héritages des enfants qui ont été pris en Europe.
So essentially what ended up happening was the children were taken from Europe to West Africa. They were forced into Christianity, baptized and enslaved, in which they eventually made their way to the Caribbean and the Americas.
Les enfants ont été pris et ont été forcés à la chrétienté et ont été envoyés en Afrique de l'Ouest et après ont été mis en esclave et ont été envoyés sur des bateaux dans les Caraïbes.
All right, thank you. I have a video I need to show, but as I look for this video, this is coming to me by the Most High. Does anybody have any questions or they have any statements they may want to make, go ahead and make them now.
Wayne, I want to say, you know, we are truly a set apart. We are truly a set apart people because, I mean, when you look at, at least for me, when I look at what's going on in America, how the black men are being treated in this country, and you know, all the YouTube video teachings that I have downloaded on my computer, and it's like, you know, it's sad, but it's like I'm not angry. So I mean, it's like we were mixed. It's like we were specially made. There's something in us that really doesn't make us really angry, but we still have a lack of forgivingness inside of us. You know, it's just amazing. I can't really articulate it. I don't know how you feel about that.
It's a mixture of things that by nature, we are not a violent people. Yet part of our issue is we've been domesticated. This is what it ultimately comes down to. So, I mean, this got to keep it 1,000. We've been domesticated. We've been taught the scriptures in error. Sadly. So, for instance, and I can't get too deep into it, but I want to address, I do want to address, I do want to address this. So, we've been domesticated, and we've been taught the scriptures incorrectly to believe that we're supposed to turn the other cheek to our enemies. The reality is this. Lydia's my sister. Sheryl's my sister. Shadalah's my sister, okay? If we have a disagreement or there's some type of drama, conflict between us, okay, where my sisters become my adversaries, civil adversaries, they don't like me, they mad at me, they're mad at my family, whatever. What Jesus or Mashiach was talking about was turning the other cheek in regards to your own people. He was talking about doing what you could to keep peace amongst your own people. Like, brother man, sister girl, you got enough problems with these Gentiles kicking down your, you know, doing the most. Right?
Yeah.
Like, I need you to work together as a family is what it comes down to. That's it. Stop the drama with, you know, fighting amongst yourselves, but literally be peaceable with your brother and sister, even your adversaries. Like, there's certain Hebrew Israelite groups I don't get along with. I don't like their doctrine and a lot of their ways, but they're still my brother and my sister. And at the end of the day, I'm gonna stand right next to them. Even though they look crazy, they acting crazy, I'm gonna have their back to support them because they're my brother and my sister. So we have a faulty understanding to think that, like, old girl decided to go ahead and shoot my brother in his own house, talking about he broke into my place and he on a totally different floor than you. You had to go upstairs, right? You murdered the man, all right? I'm not going to be hugging on you, talking about I forgive you and all type of stuff. That's not how that works. We've been taught to be so docile that our open enemies can slap us, spit on us, they could rape us, they could destroy us, they could violate our women and children and little boys and girls, and we just gonna turn the other cheek and be like, it's okay. We love you. May God forgive you. I forgive you. No. No, no, no. That's part of the problem that we're dealing with as a people that have been under the understanding of Christianity. You have Gentiles that have taught from a book, okay? A book that was written by Hebrews for Hebrews with principles that apply to the entire earth. And they've hijacked it and they've inserted themselves into that book. And they've misinterpreted the words and the meanings of the words to make you think otherwise. So you got folks really walking around here with a colonized mind on multiple levels. And another aspect is, you know, making sure that they've inserted their images into our history. Because they want to make it out as though they were made in the image of God, when the reality is we were made in the image of God. Which goes into why they hide their identity so well. So that's a secret they don't really want getting out. That's why we can be black and they can be white and nobody knows the truth. Nobody knows the truth. It's a hidden secret nobody wants to talk about. So you talk about, I know who I am. And when you know who you are, people treat you different. You carry a different authority when you walk. We already walk around with an authority as it is. But even amongst our own, there's a different walk that you have when you come into the knowledge of this truth. So, but let's open this up. I do got a video I want to show you guys real quick. Anybody have any other questions, any statements they want to make? I don't want to hold you guys much longer, maybe about 10 more minutes. That's about it. So anybody have any words they want to say, any statements they want to make, anything they want to say to those that may watch this in the future? Just jump right ahead and go say something.
You know, one of the things that amazes me as I go through this journey is how much brainwashing we have had and how difficult it is to unravel the brainwashing. When Cheryl and I first came to this understanding, I think we spent about a week and a half just in astonishment.
Yeah.
That this could actually be the reality. It has taken me about 3 to 4 years to accept that this thing is true. Because we were brought up in church and we were told and told over and over again that this is how it is and these are, and you know, especially like you said, gentle Jesus, meek and mild. Oh, you must be forgiving and you must be nice to everybody. Even when they are stepping on your neck and killing you, you must still be nice and kind. And it is my fervent prayer. May the Father forgive me if I am wrong. But he says, with whatever measure you have meted, it will be meted back to you. And I'm awaiting the vengeance. I think that's the word. Vengeance is mine, saith the Lord.
Mm-hmm.
I'm awaiting it because they have done so much.
Mm-hmm. Too much.
So many areas. And they have gone above and beyond their cruelty to us. And I'm awaiting to see what the Father is going to do after he has gathered us and taken us out of their jurisdiction. I'm awaiting what he is going to do because they have just been outrageous.
Yeah, the judgment is here right now. That's why the whole world's gone stupid. The world's gone stupid. It's just, there's no other way you could describe it. It's just going plain stone cold crazy. Like, this is where it's important for us to get connected. Like, honestly, one of the root reasons why a lot of this is happening right now for me and what you guys see me doing fervently is because I recognize time is short. I recognize the season that we have to connect with each other. We need to have more dialogues and discussions like this. We're not going to always agree on everything, and that's cool. But we need to be able to dialogue, discuss things, hammer out those issues, deal with crimes that we've committed against each other, and then really do turn the other cheek when it comes to each other. Not these other folks. They got to pay for what they've done, okay? And honestly, individually, we are paying for the sins we've committed, our forefathers have committed. But I'm going to say this real quick. It's just raising up in my spirit, man, right now. Listen, y'all, those of y'all that are listening right now got to get together, okay? I know what we do, all of us, what we do. Stop playing around. Stop playing church. I'm seeing too many of our brothers and sisters messing around with stones and rocks, and they got crystal altars, and they sacrificing animals to the little garden god in the back.
Oh, Lord.
Stop tripping. You tripping right now. Straight tripping. Motivated by greed, lust, and money. Tripping. Dabbling in Obia. You messing with some of the same spiritual wickedness that our forefathers and foremothers was dabbling in back in the day. They just got new names. 100. I'm going to do a video on all that too. All that, all them fertility goddesses and stuff like that and messing with the water, these little mermaid people and all that stuff. You got plates with food on it in the back for folks? I know what our people be doing. I know what they be doing. They better get it together and repent. Because everything's going to burn. Everything that's not of the Most High Yah is going to get roasted. People going to be looking stupid trying to figure out what happened. Listen, this age is over with all this nonsense that we was dealing with before. Everybody has to give account. Everybody. Everybody. So, like, these folks messing around with crystal altars and rune stones and sage burning and all this type of stuff. Listen, I'm not saying it don't work. I'm saying it's out of order. I'm saying it's wrong. I'm saying you are leaning your ear to the wrong Elohim, the wrong God. You messing with Orishas and everybody else? Listen, I'm going to stop because I can't break out into a whole new lesson because I can do that. I got to stop. So we'll deal with that. We'll deal with all that stuff. All I'm saying is you got a heads up right now. Y'all better stop playing around. Y'all better stop playing around. Listen, I'm not going to be one to do nothing to you. This is going to be the Most High. I'm your brother giving you the warning. Like, these folks out here messing around with this stuff. Man, listen, I'll end with this. Even these folks are our people in Christianity. They in Islam. They in, you know, Rastafarianism. Listen. Repent. If you got secret sins, which most people do, deal with your secret sins. Deal with your secret sins. Like, when the Most High come back, he's coming back for real. When that, listen, if you have to go before the throne of grace, mercy, and judgment, and you have to pass the gaze of inspection from the Most High Yah, are you going to be ready for that? Are you ready for your life to be an open book, to be inspected by the Most High, where nothing is secret? Then we all may want to repent. We all may want to actually get our hearts right and go to the Most High in forgiveness of our sins. You got to go to Yah Salvation, otherwise known as Jesus Christ or Yahusha, and go to him in humility and mercy. Like, just please forgive me. These are my faults. These are my sins. These are my struggles. This is what I'm dealing with. I repent. I give them over to you. Show me the way. Show me the path. Like, just because we came into the awakening as Hebrew Israelites doesn't mean they're like, Yeshua is still there. You still have to be born again. It's not just turning back to the law, statutes, and commandments and you cool. Because our forefathers and foremothers knew the law, statutes, and commandments, even walked some of them out very well. But we need, listen, the Messiah, Jesus Christ, or Yeshua HaMashiach, came for a reason. He came to reconcile us as a people back to the Father. We still got to pay for our sins. His blood is still on our hands. But he came to reconcile us back. That's what he came for. People don't even know what he came for. The whole world. What did he say? He said, I came for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. He didn't come for Jews. He didn't come for Judah. He didn't come for just the kingdom of Judah. He said, I come for the lost sheep of the house of Israel. That's all 12 tribes that have been scattered, that have been divided, that have been scattered throughout the whole winds of the earth. That's what he said he came for. We the ones that need salvation. Everybody else and their mama out in these streets has had the opportunity to turn and seek after Torah, to seek after instruction from the Most High God. Everybody's had the opportunity. Jesus dying, getting buried, and resurrecting had nothing to do with these other folks. These other folks had no covenant. Our people had a covenant. Our people our forefathers and foremothers stood on that mountain and said, I do. And it wasn't only them, it was them and their seed, which is y'all, which is me. We have the covenant. We have the covenant responsibility. And that's partially why many of our family members run, because it's easier to sit on your hands and be a good Christian and just pay your tithe money and go to church and get a good word and dance around a little bit, sing some songs, than it is to truly live and walk this thing out. Go ahead.
Did you allow me to translate that? Because I really
feel
like it's important.
Go ahead, please.
Il est temps de se repentir. Il est vraiment temps de se retourner, de tourner de notre chrétienté et de se tourner vers le Dieu véritable, vers la Torah, vers les instructions des livres de la Bible. Il faut arrêter de juste aller à l'église et d'avaler les mensonges des pasteurs et des églises. Il faut ouvrir la Bible et la lire, surtout les premiers 5 livres de la Torah, qui sont la vérité et les instructions de Dieu. Et je vais lire Matthieu 10, 6. « N'allez pas vers les païens et n'entrez pas dans les villes des Samaritains. Allez plutôt vers les brebis perdues de la maison d'Israël. » Yehoshua HaMashiach, ou Jésus-Christ, est venu pour la maison perdue, les brebis perdues de la maison d'Israël. Donc, ça inclut bien les 12 tribus d'Israël. Donc, il faut vous éveiller, il faut vous relever et il faut vous retourner vers le Dieu véritable, le Dieu de la Torah et des instructions. Toda Ak.
Appreciate it. So, yeah, I mean, bottom line is that we need to deal with the secret sins of our heart. We know what we do, the good, the bad, and the ugly. We have to go down Romans 10 and 9, it still exists, and be humble. Because oftentimes, the mistake that people make is that they think, I could just follow the law, statutes, and commandments, and I'm good. There's no way. If not saying that you can't be proactive to go after the righteous things of the Most High, but without the salvation that comes from Yah, from God, I'm not gonna make it. So anybody else have anything they wanna say before we end this? I wanna stop. I can keep going, obviously, but I wanna be considerate of your time. I know it's late. Any parting words, any words of encouragement to our people in the Caribbean to join us? Please go ahead.
Yes, I just want to let, I think it's G8, he spoke. I just want to let him know that he's not alone over there in his frustration. We also, here in the rest of the Caribbean, in other Caribbean regions, we also experience the level of frustration that he's experiencing, especially when we try to speak to our family members, especially our immediate family members, about the awakening, about this truth. I have had, you know, people really turn their head away, literally. So you're not alone. We are experiencing it as well. And just like Maurice said, sometimes you are not the best person to reach your family members. Maybe somebody else will reach them, but you shouldn't stop sharing,
right,
and planting the seed. Another question I have for you, Duane, is that throughout the course of the sessions for the Caribbean, will you be systematically going through some of the history? Because for a lot of us, yeah, our history is up to Christopher Columbus arriving on our island.
Really?
And that's about it.
That ain't gonna work.
It goes up to there, and nobody knows really and truly what was happening before. So we, Debbie and myself, we have gone through some of the history. We have looked up some of the history. Mm-hmm. We are not history buffs, but it would be really nice if we could get some breakdown, further breakdown of the history of what happened with some of, with Jamaica, some of the other islands. Because in our situation, mm-hmm. we have to remember that, well, our motto is out of many, one. So in our experience, in our generation and our experience, we grew up having a sense of all-inclusiveness. You're born Jamaican, you're Jamaican. You're just Jamaican. Okay? But we have to remember that there were immigrants. What do they call them? Indentured laborers, mm-hmm. Indians, Chinese, and so on, who came into our country. And there have been a lot of intermingling. Mm-hmm. And so because a lot of the history is lost on us, it is very difficult at this time for a lot of persons to delineate ancestry. All right. Now, Chinese, of course, that's being said, if you're Indian, yes. But the mixing is there. Mm-hmm. And it is very, very, very deep and pervasive. And some of us cannot determine our genealogy, for want of a better term, our family tree. It's just lost 2-3. We can only go back maybe a great, great. And we don't know what happened there, you know, before. So at least learning, getting the history open and, you know, getting as clear as possible, you know, line and explanation about the history of how the people got here, what happened to us. We of course have been doing our own research, as I said, but for other persons who may be new to this program or new to the awakening, the history is very important. And it is sadly lacking. So it yeah. would be nice if we could get in a bit of that.
Yeah, I will definitely do some things, little nuggets here and there. Maybe we can work something out to break it down. Each time we'll deal with
you're breaking
the
apart a bit, so we're not hearing what you're saying.
Yeah, I think it's on your side. That's an assumption. I don't know. It could be on my side. You were breaking up while you're talking, but what can you do? Like, it'll clear up or it won't. So, but yeah, we'll work on that. We'll work on that. We'll put something together to deal with the various islands. I have a lot of history on what happened in the islands. It was bad. It was bad. It was bad. And I will say some things I have content on and things I've done, I've not shared with anybody openly because it's too personal. Like, you're dealing with some deep, deep, deep wounds of our people that don't need to be broadcasted to everybody on like the internet. So like the issue of colorism and how many of our people are doing skin white lightening creams and, you know, the acid peels, and they're doing the absolute most. The desire to suicide oneself by mixing in with other nations for that purpose. If not just be like, do first and foremost, I'm not for intermixing with other nations at all. I truly despise it on a deep level that people can't even imagine. But it's one of those things where, do I believe you could find true love in a male or female from another nation? Yes, I do. But that's not the course of action that we as Israelites have been called to do. To me, I look at it, it takes an Israelite man and an Israelite woman to raise an Israelite child. Period. Things have happened, things are happening, and we're working through that process right now. And so it'll all work itself out in the end. You know, we'll get through it. Our people have been scattered everywhere. There are situations where, you know, our forefathers and foremothers, but specifically our foremothers, were raped and had children via rape. A lot in the Caribbean, a lot of sexual abuse happened in the Caribbean that people don't want to talk about. It's bad. It's bad when you look at the history. So we'll get into that. We'll get into all that as appropriate. Okay. And so you guys just, I'm here for you. Like truly, like this is, I'm taking the time out of my midday to, or my midweek to come and be a part and fellowship with you guys. So I will go in the direction you guys need and want me to go in. But obviously, first and foremost, I want to make sure that we are acknowledging who we are. We're acknowledging Yeshua as the Messiah. We, you know, all that was done to reconcile us back to the Father, and get that critical information to our people that just don't know. Like, I know that when I eventually share this video and target it specifically to those in the Caribbean and other French-speaking nations within Africa, they're going to be enlightened just by this dialogue and conversation. So, but I'm going to end right here. I do have a video, so I don't want to not show that. If you need to go, you can go. But does anyone else have anything they want to say before we close? All right, I want to thank you all for joining me this midweek fellowship for the Caribbean Hebrew session. And Lydia, I want to just give you immense props and thanks for assisting in getting this word out to our people. May Yah bless you 1,000-fold. And I greatly, genuinely in my heart, appreciate you, your husband, and all that you guys do. My brother in San Antonio, there is an assembly there that you can get connected with. So you definitely want to reach out. Lydia, okay. Do you have the email you guys are using right now?
We know Mike.
Okay, good. I was going to say, if he didn't know, I wasn't sure.
Yeah.
So.
We know.
All right, that's yes, good. I know Lydia.
Very, very good.
I just want to say Toda Rabba for this opportunity, Aki, because it's me who is blessed right now by this, being able to for the Ruach to guide me through the translation. I was very, very emotional. I was really trying to keep my voice straight.
You did a great job.
Thank you. This is my people, you know, West Africa, Haiti, all those are my people. All my friends, mostly my long-lasting friends, are from over there. So it's an opportunity for me also to share with them. So Toda Rabba and all praise to the Most High.
Absolutely. All right. I'm going to go ahead and close out in prayer, and then I'm going to play the last little bit of a video I had put together. And it actually shows the transatlantic slave trade, the scattering of the 12 tribes of Israel, but specifically you're dealing with the southern kingdom of Judah. I have much to speak on, much to talk about, but it's just too much for right now. We got to close out. So I appreciate you all. Let me go ahead and close out in prayer, and then I will play this video, and then I will end the call. So after I pray, that'll be the last I speak. The rest will just be a video for those of you that stick around to watch it and those that are be watching later online. So Abiyah, thank you for this time that me and my brothers and sisters were able to come before your throne of grace, mercy, and judgment. We love you, Yah. We thank you for, again, everything you're doing in and through our lives and the opportunity to have this fellowship, to have strength, to have sanity of mind, to have good health, during this season. We thank you for that. We don't take it for granted. We thank you for the opportunity to come together across state and geographical boundaries. I pray that this Caribbean Hebrew Fellowship is a blessing to many, and that this lesson goes far and wide to our people to edify and encourage them in the truth, to seek the truth of who you are and who they are in you. I pray for a hedge of protection to be upon everyone, their family, and all that they're stewards over. I pray for a restful sleep this evening, and that your hand be upon us all. In the mighty name of Yeshua HaMashiach, amen, amen, hallelujah.
Amen, praise Yah.
Hallelujah.
Our family, yeah. I will talk to you guys soon. You guys definitely hit me up via email or the website, or how are you going to try to contact me? I appreciate you guys. All right, I'll play this video and then I will end the call after that. Shalom, everybody.
Shalom. Thank you, brother. Hello.
Anticlimactic, but let me go ahead and fix that. That's funny. I wonder why I did that. That's what I want. That's what I want. Hey, why not? Here we go.
To the house of Jacob, and what you are to tell the people of Israel. You yourselves have seen what I did to Egypt, and how I carried you on eagle's wings and brought you to myself. Now, if you obey me fully and keep my covenant, then out of all nations, you will be my treasured possession. Although the whole earth is mine, you will be for me a kingdom of priests and a holy nation. These are the words you are to speak to the Israelites.
So Moses went back and summoned the elders of the people and set before them all the words the Lord had commanded him to speak. The people all responded together.
we will do everything the Lord has said.
So Moses brought their answer back to the Lord. The Lord said to Moses,
I am going to come to you in a dense cloud, so that the people will hear me speaking with you and will always put their trust in you.
Then Moses told the Lord what the people had said. And the Lord said to Moses,
Go to the people and consecrate them today and tomorrow. Have them wash their clothes and be ready by the third day, because on that day, the Lord will come down on Mount Sinai in the sight of all the people. Put limits for the people around the mountain and tell them, be careful that you do not approach the mountain or touch the foot of it. Whoever touches the mountain is to be put to death. They are to be stoned or shot with arrows. Not a hand is to be laid on them, whether people or animals. They shall not be permitted to live. Only when the ram's horn sounds a long blast may they approach the mountain.
After Moses had gone down the mountain to the people, he consecrated them, and they washed their clothes. Then he said to the people,
Prepare yourselves for the third day. Abstain from sexual relations.
On the morning of the third day, there was thunder and lightning with a thick cloud over the mountain and a very loud trumpet blast. Everyone in the camp trembled. Then Moses led the people out of the camp to meet with God, and they stood at the foot of the mountain. Mount Sinai was covered with smoke because the Lord descended on it in fire. The smoke billowed up from it like smoke from a furnace, and the whole mountain trembled violently. As the sound of the trumpet grew louder and louder, Moses spoke, and the voice of God answered him. The Lord descended to the top of Mount Sinai and called Moses to the top of the mountain. So Moses went up, and the Lord said to him,
Go down and warn the people, so they do not force their way through to see the Lord, and many of them perish. Even the priests who approach the Lord must consecrate themselves, or the Lord will break out against them.
Moses said to the Lord,
The people cannot come up Mount Sinai, because you yourself warned us. Put limits around the mountain and set it apart as holy.
The Lord replied,
Go down and bring Aaron up with you. But the priests and the people must not force their way through to come up to the Lord, or he will break out against them.
So Moses went down to the people and told them, and God spoke all these words.
I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or on the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down to them or worship them, for I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sin of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to a thousand generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. You shall not misuse the name of the Lord your God, for the Lord will not hold anyone guiltless who misuses his name. Remember the Sabbath day by keeping it holy. 6 days you shall labor and do all your work, but the seventh day is a Sabbath to the Lord your God. On it you shall not do any work, neither you, nor your son or daughter, nor your male or female servant, nor your animals, nor any foreigner residing in your towns. For in 6 days the Lord made the heavens and the earth, the sea and all that is in them. But he rested on the seventh day. Therefore, the Lord blessed the Sabbath day and made it holy. Honor your father and your mother, so that you may live long in the land the Lord your God is giving you. You shall not murder. You shall not commit adultery. You shall not steal. You shall not give false testimony against your neighbor. You shall not covet your neighbor's house. You shall not covet your neighbor's wife, or his male or female servant, his ox or donkey, or anything that belongs to your neighbor.
When the people saw the thunder and lightning, and heard the trumpet, and saw the mountain in smoke, they trembled with fear. They stayed at a distance and said to Moses,
"Speak to us yourself and we will listen. But do not have God speak to us, or we will die."
Moses said to the people,
"Do not be afraid. God has come to test you, so that the fear of God will be with you to keep you from sinning."
The people remained at a distance while Moses approached the thick darkness where God was. Then the Lord said to Moses,
"Tell the Israelites this. You have seen for yourselves that I have spoken to you from heaven. Do not make any gods to be alongside me. Do not make for yourselves gods of silver or gods of gold. Make an altar of earth for me and sacrifice on it your burnt offerings and fellowship offerings, your sheep and goats and your cattle. Wherever I cause my name to be honored, I will come to you and bless you. If you make an altar of stones for me, do not build it with dressed stones, for you will defile it if you use a tool on it. And do not go up to my altar on steps, lest your nakedness be exposed on it. These are the laws you are to set before them."
Blessings, family. That was Exodus chapter 19 and 20, the giving of the commandments of Yah. Very, very powerful. And it's something to reflect on during this Day of Atonement. Now I want to transition to Deuteronomy chapter 28, which is the establishment of the covenant between Yah and the children of Israel. This is right before they are about to enter into the promised land, and this covenant is being struck between Yahweh Elohim and the children of Israel. This is the giving of the blessings and the cursing. If we uphold our end of the covenant, Yah will bless us. But obviously, we did not uphold our end of the covenant, and therefore, we to this day are living out the curses of Deuteronomy 28. We are the remnant that survived the curses of Deuteronomy 28. So Yah has a special place in his heart for you because you made it. You survived. And I need you to know that. So without further ado, Deuteronomy chapter 28.
"If you fully obey the Lord your God and carefully follow all his commands I give you today, the Lord your God will set you high above all the nations on earth. All these blessings will come on you and accompany you if you obey the Lord your God. You will be blessed in the city and blessed in the country. The fruit of your womb will be blessed, and the crops of your land and the young of your livestock. the calves of your herds and the lambs of your flocks. Your basket and your kneading trough will be blessed. You will be blessed when you come in and blessed when you go out. The Lord will grant that the enemies who rise up against you will be defeated before you. They will come at you from one direction, but flee from you in seven. The Lord will send a blessing on your barns and on everything you put your hand to. The Lord your God will bless you in the land he is giving you. The Lord will establish you as his holy people, as he promised you on oath, if you keep the commands of the Lord your God and walk in obedience to him. Then all the peoples on earth will see that you are called by the name of the Lord, and they will fear you. The Lord will grant you abundant prosperity in the fruit of your womb, the young of your livestock, and the crops of your ground in the land he swore to your ancestors to give you. The Lord will open the heavens, the storehouse of his bounty, to send rain on your land in season and to bless all the work of your hands. You will lend to many nations, but will borrow from none. The Lord will make you the head, not the tail. If you pay attention to the commands of the Lord your God that I give you this day and carefully follow them, you will always be at the top, never at the bottom. Do not turn aside from any of the commands I give you today, to the right or to the left, following other gods and serving them. However, if you do not obey the Lord your God and do not carefully follow all his commands and decrees I am giving you today, all these curses will come on you and overtake you. You will be cursed in the city and cursed in the country. Your basket and your kneading trough will be cursed. The fruit of your womb will be cursed, and the crops of your land, and the calves of your herds, and the lambs of your flocks. You will be cursed when you come in, and cursed when you go out. The Lord will send on you curses, confusion, and rebuke in everything you put your hand to, until you are destroyed and come to sudden ruin because of the evil you have done in forsaking him. The Lord will plague you with diseases until he has destroyed you from the land you are entering to possess. The Lord will strike you with wasting disease, with fever and inflammation, with scorching heat and drought, with blight and mildew, which will plague you until you perish. The sky over your head will be bronze, the ground beneath you iron. The Lord will turn the rain of your country into dust and powder. It will come down from the skies until you are destroyed. The Lord will cause you to be defeated before your enemies. You will come at them from one direction, but flee from them in seven, and you will become a thing of horror to all the kingdoms on earth. Your carcasses will be food for all the birds and the wild animals, and there will be no one to frighten them away. The Lord will afflict you with the boils of Egypt, and with tumors, festering sores, and the itch from which you cannot be cured. The Lord will afflict you with madness, blindness, and confusion of mind. At midday, you will grope about like a blind person in the dark. You will be unsuccessful in everything you do. Day after day, you will be oppressed and robbed with no one to rescue you. You will be pledged to be married to a woman, but another will take her and ravish her. You will build a house, but you will not live in it. You will plant a vineyard, but you will not even begin to enjoy its fruit. Your ox will be slaughtered before your eyes, but you will eat none of it. Your donkey will be forcibly taken from you and will not be returned. Your sheep will be given to your enemies and no one will rescue them. Your sons and daughters will be given to another nation, and you will wear out your eyes, watching for them day after day, powerless to lift a hand. A people that you do not know will eat what your land and labor produce, and you will have nothing but cruel oppression all your days. The sight you see will drive you mad. The Lord will afflict your knees and legs with painful boils that cannot be cured, spreading from the soles of your feet to the top of your head. The Lord will drive you and the king you set over you to a nation unknown to you or your ancestors. There you will worship other gods. Gods of wood and stone. You will become a thing of horror, a byword, and an object of ridicule among all the peoples where the Lord will drive you. You will sow much seed in the field, but you will harvest little, because locusts will devour it. You will plant vineyards and cultivate them, but you will not drink the wine or gather the grapes, because worms will eat them. You will have olive trees throughout your country, but you will not use the oil, because the olives will drop off. You will have sons and daughters, but you will not keep them, because they will go into captivity. Swarms of locusts will take over all your trees and the crops of your land. The foreigners who reside among you will rise above you higher and higher, but you will sink lower and lower. They will lend to you, but you will not lend to them. They will be the head, but you will be the tail. All these curses will come on you. They will pursue you and overtake you until you are destroyed, because you did not obey the Lord your God and observe the commands and decrees he gave you. They will be a sign and a wonder to you and your descendants forever, because you did not serve the Lord your God joyfully and gladly in the time of prosperity. Therefore, in hunger and thirst, in nakedness and dire poverty, you will serve the enemies the Lord sends against you. He will put an iron yoke on your neck until he has destroyed you. The Lord will bring a nation against you from far away, from the ends of the earth, like an eagle swooping down, a nation whose language you will not understand, a fierce-looking nation without respect for the old or pity for the young. They will devour the young of your livestock and the crops of your land until you are destroyed. They will leave you no grain, new wine or olive oil, nor any calves of your herds or lambs of your flocks until you are ruined. They will lay siege to all the cities throughout your land until the high fortified walls in which you trust fall down. They will besiege all the cities throughout the land the Lord your God is giving you. Because of the suffering that your enemy will inflict on you during the siege, you will eat the fruit of the womb, the flesh of the sons and daughters the Lord your God has given you. Even the most gentle and sensitive man among you will have no compassion on his own brother or the wife he loves or his surviving children, and he will not give to one of them any of the flesh of his children that he is eating. It will be all he has left because of the suffering your enemy will inflict on you during the siege of all your cities. The most gentle and sensitive woman among you, so sensitive and gentle that she would not venture to touch the ground with the sole of her foot, will begrudge the husband she loves and her own son or daughter, the afterbirth from her womb and the children she bears. For in her dire need, she intends to eat them secretly because of the suffering your enemy will inflict on you during the siege of your cities. If you do not carefully follow all the words of this law, which are written in this book, and do not revere this glorious and awesome name, the Lord your God, the Lord will send fearful plagues on you and your descendants, harsh and prolonged disasters, and severe and lingering illnesses. He will bring on you all the diseases of Egypt that you dreaded, and they will cling to you. The Lord will also bring on you every kind of sickness and disaster not recorded in this book of the law until you are destroyed. You, who were as numerous as the stars in the sky, will be left but few in number because you did not obey the Lord your God. Just as it pleased the Lord to make you prosper and increase in number, so it will please him to ruin and destroy you. You will be uprooted from the land you are entering to possess. Then the Lord will scatter you among all nations, from one end of the earth to the other. There you will worship other gods. Gods of wood and stone, which neither you nor your ancestors have known. Among those nations, you will find no repose, no resting place for the sole of your foot. There the Lord will give you an anxious mind, eyes weary with longing, and a despairing heart. You will live in constant suspense, filled with dread both night and day, never sure of your life. In the morning you will say, "If only it were evening," and in the evening, "If only it were morning," because of the terror that will fill your hearts and the sights that your eyes will see. The Lord will send you back in ships to Egypt on a journey, I said, you should never make again. There you will offer yourselves for sale to your enemies as male and female slaves, but no one will buy you.